Hi, everyone. My name is Fraser Cain. I'm the publisher of Universe Today, and it is your weekly space hangout for March 22nd, 2013. So this week, we've got a bunch of stories, and we're going to do this a little differently, I think. So we're going to experiment. We're going to mix things up a little bit, so we'll see if this works or not. So we're going to be talking about the new observations from the Planck Observatory. Talking about how the Apollo rocket engines have been recovered from the seafloor by Jeff Bezos and company, that Voyager 1 has left the solar system, or has it? Cool photographs and updates on comet Pan-STARRS and how you could see it for yourself. Crazy jets on Enceladus that may reach all the way down to its salty ocean. A big story that we missed last week, which is how the environment on Mars is ripe for life, and the asteroid defense hearing that have happened this week. So joining me this week, we've got Alan Boyle from NBC.
Greetings.
That is your catchphrase now. It's someone else's.
LLIP, man.
Jason Major from Lights in the Dark and Universe Today and other places. And Dr. Thad Szabo from Cerritos College.
Hello.
All right. So I think the big story, and this is the one that I think people don't know this is the big story, but this is the big story. And so I think once we're done, hopefully everyone will be left walking around, scratching their head, pondering their place in the cosmos, and wondering if anything really matters anymore. And so this is the new observations from the Planck Observatory. And they released the most precise map of the universe and pushed the age back for the universe by 100 years. Sorry, by 100 million years. Yeah.
Jason, who's counting?
You got a lot of mic noise there. I'm not sure it's coming from you, Jason.
Is it coming from me?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. But I think the other part is the implications for inflationary cosmology. And that, I think you were sort of freaking us out before we even started the conversation. So. I guess to go back a bit, what is this new map that Planck has released?
So if we're looking at light that's left over from 380,000 years after the Big Bang, before that you had electrons and protons doing kind of separate motions because it was so hot that the universe was essentially a plasma. At this point, the universe cools down, the electrons join up with the protons, and light goes free. And so this light is essentially coming from all directions. It essentially fills the universe, and it gives us, it's the first light that's available for making a map of the early universe, and it's also impacted by these kind of small variations that would have come from fluctuations in matter and other properties of the universe before the light went free. So it's a picture of light from 380,000 years or 370,000 years after the Big Bang, but it gives us a picture back to much closer times, you know, much closer in time to the Big Bang, because of these small fluctuations in it, which Jason is showing a picture of right now. So I guess the big thing is there were assumptions that had been made from previous observations of the universe that there's three elements. There's the geometry of the universe, meaning is it curved so that it would close back in on itself? Is it curved so that it would open forever? Is it closed, open, or flat? And the observations pointed at it being flat, which is weird because as time goes on, it should evolve to one or the other, either closed or open. There was the idea of homogeneity, that everywhere you look in the universe on a certain scale of about 100 megaparsecs, if you take blocks that are about 300 million light years on a side, that you should see roughly the same contents and the same density, the same structure in all directions. And there is the idea of isotropy, that on a large basis, again, looking in all directions, you see roughly the same temperature, density, and other properties in all directions. So we had hints, and the thing is that all of our ideas about the development of the universe are based on these three principles. To explain them, why is the universe so uniform? Why is it flat? The idea of inflation was introduced, and it's been around since the early 1980s. WMAP had some hints that maybe this isn't the right picture, that the ideas we've been basing all of our understanding of the development of the universe on, there might be some problems with them, but but WMAP wasn't sensitive enough to say whether this was real. Planck is sensitive enough, and so we're doing some real precision cosmology here, and the idea that it's all the same contents, density, and structure in the same directions might have to be thrown out. It looks from the data that we know so far that it will have to be, and the idea of isotropy also has to be thrown out. The universe looks like it's hotter in one direction than it is in the other direction. So this, you know, should not be according to the ideas of inflationary theory. And so the primary understanding for how the universe got to look the way that it looks, or at least that we thought it looked, because we didn't have precise enough measurements, likely has to be thrown out.
So are you saying that likely the whole concept of inflation might have to get thrown out?
Very possibly. Yeah, because, I mean, the idea is, if you had a universe, the idea is this: right after the Big Bang, if you have the same temperature in all directions, you have the same structure in all directions, this means that parts that were 13.8 billion light years in this direction and 13.8 billion light years in this direction had to have been in contact at some point in time. But they're 27.6 billion light years apart, and with the finite speed of light, they never could have been in contact. So the idea with inflation was introduced that, well, they were at one point, and then shortly after the Big Bang, the universe expanded faster than the speed of light, which is allowed. You can't travel through the universe faster than the speed of light, but space and time itself is not constrained by those rules. So the space-time continuum itself could expand faster than the speed of light. All right, well, this takes care of the flatness problem, it takes care of homogeneity, it takes care of isotropy. Yeah, but if it's not homogeneous and it's not isotropic, then do we really need inflation? Or is it just extraneous? And there have been hints of this coming along for a while. The first physics professor I had in college was Paul Steinhardt, and he was one of the pioneers of the inflationary theory. But he's been questioning it quite seriously for the past decade or so. And, you know, here's kind of something to show that, you know, maybe this was not the right approach, but we just didn't have measurements to understand that it wasn't the right approach before. So this, you know, aside from, yeah, it's 100 million years older, small adjustment, and there were hints of that already, throwing out inflation, that's enormous.
Right. And so does that mean, I mean, inflation was almost like a kludge, or like, you know, some way to explain this, you know, how could the right-hand side of the sky be the same as the left-hand? At some point, they had to be touching. And so now, you're saying, well, that's actually not the case anymore. We don't need this very complicated, very mind-bending rate of expansion early on in the universe. So does it point towards just a more, a normal is not the word I would really use, but a sort of a more understandable rate of expansion in the early universe, something that would be a lot more as predicted before the whole concept of inflation? Like, if we, you know, is it time to just take inflation just out and just go back to what was before inflation, the ideas?
It's even bigger than that. If there was no inflation, this means we have to postulate about what the conditions were before the Big Bang, which has never been something that's ever had to come up before. Because we see these structures, and if we understand conditions from the time of the Big Bang, with current models, they shouldn't exist. We got a little bit ahead of this a while ago with the large structure of quasars, dense structure of quasars, and I guess the jury's still out on this one, but the results from Planck show that there's structure there that, according to current ideas and according to current models, should not exist. They contradict current models. And so some of the ideas that... This is fledgling. This is new science
that's
coming out this week. So we'll have to see how it plays out. And that's pretty exciting, that we may have to start talking about what happened before the Big Bang.
And so when you say, what happened before? Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, I'm just a science writer, so I just go by what other people tell me about this stuff. But the spin that was coming from ESA and NASA was that this actually was a really good confirmation of the current standard model for cosmology, that there are some strange aspects like the the large scale distribution of temperature variation appears to follow the ecliptic plane. It's a little warmer in the south and a little colder in the north. And so that's something that they're scratching their heads over. But it didn't sound as if they were ready to kind of throw the whole inflationary universe baby out with the bathwater. That it sounded as if, in fact, they said that the more complicated theories on inflation didn't really have as much support as a more simple view of how inflation worked. So definitely there are some things that that they're scratching their heads over. But when you see something that's dependent on, you know, northern hemisphere versus southern hemisphere, I think the first thing you ask is whether there's some effect that they're not taking into account with closer in phenomena. And so far they haven't found that, but I don't think they're quite ready to throw in the towel quite yet. At least that's the impression I got.
Yeah, but I love this kind of story, because you get this sort of back and forth. You get a certain kind of understanding of the way the universe works, and then something else comes along that kind of changes it, and then it takes confirmation, and you get to watch this all unfold in slow motion over the months and years ahead as people start to sort of understand what these measurements mean. But it's great to have a measurement that's so precise.
I mean, yeah, Thad is right that there's a lot to dig into there, and it's more interesting even than the Higgs boson discovery, because Higgs, there was really nothing that you could latch onto and say, wow, this is going to pull us up to the next level, and they are finding that with Planck.
And I should mention that, yes, I mean, you're correct in that most of the standard model of cosmology is confirmed, that there's slight adjustments. Again, age of the universe, Hubble parameter. We now know that the amount of matter in the universe versus dark energy, there's slightly more matter, there's slightly less dark energy than we thought before. But all of the parameters that we'd had a pretty good fix on from before with WMAP, we have a much better fix on now from Planck. The one thing that did show up on WMAP was this cold spot, which is this large structure. You know, there's no way to explain it with the ideas of homogeneity and isotropy, and it's confirmed with Planck. And so, again, this is what's raising some questions and possibly introduces some really new ways of thinking about the origins of the universe.
And right, that was an anomaly in the WMAP data, you know, possibly. And then so pretty much Planck said, no, it's not an anomaly. This cold spot is there, and here it is.
That's it, and it's too large. I mean, the thing is, if you look at there's a scale that has to go with our current standard model of cosmology, that nothing can be larger than, I think it's about 300 megaparsecs. If you look at the size of this cold spot, it exceeds that. And so these things should not exist under the current standard model. So, you know, it points to most of it's confirmed. Dark energy is still close to 70%. It's 68% of the current energy budget of the universe. Dark matter is now about 26% instead of 22%. Baryonic matter, atoms, the stuff you and I are made from, goes up to 5% instead of 4%.
Yay!
So we're slightly more
5%,
important.
Baby!
Yay! Yeah. Okay, so again, there's small adjustments, but again, these larger anomalies like the cold spot just shouldn't exist according to
And Thad, wasn't there something, I know there had been a lot of discussion about whether you could find evidence for interaction with other bubble universes, for example, by looking at the imprint of the cosmic microwave background. Is that cold spot the sort of thing that they might be looking for touching bubbles?
That becomes a possibility, like a collision between brains or touching, you know, bubbles, other universes that may have formed, and here's a point where energy would have been transferred out of our universe into that other universe, if it even possibly exists. So, that's the thing. You shouldn't see places that are overly, I should be careful. I shouldn't say overly warm. The differences in temperature we're looking at here, if the cosmic microwave background is 2.7 Kelvin, the differences in temperature are about 100,000 times less than that in magnitude. So it's not like, oh, it's just really cold, but it's enough of a difference based on the way our current understanding of the evolution of the universe should be that we shouldn't find this large of an area that is overall a few millionths, tens of millionths of a Kelvin lower in temperature than the rest of it. So, you know, it's like, where'd this energy go? And so one of the ideas is, well, maybe there's a collision between universes. If you look at the graphic that Jason has up there now, it's down in the lower right.
Oh, the thing that's circled picture. There.
The thing that's circled. So the anomaly of it being warmer in the northern, you know, above the solar system versus below the solar system, and again, that could be systematic. That's shown by the line, but that cold spot, that's been there from you know, WMAP data, and now it's pretty well confirmed.
And that particular graphic, they've enhanced the color differences, and so when you look at that, it's really obvious, but that's the point, is that in the actual map, you're not going to see it quite that obviously, so that's one thing to keep in mind.
Right. What they've done is they said, okay, here's the map from Planck, and here's a map that shows, you know, what variation should be according to current theory, and they subtract the two, so it highlights the differences. So this is, you know, difference between experiment and theory, and yeah, the cold spot shows up pretty well, and then there's this also this other kind of gradient, which again, if it's real, it means the universe is currently a few tens of millions of a degree warmer in one direction than it is in the other direction, which again goes against isotropy. But like you said, it is something that's split kind of along the ecliptic plane, which hints it's systematic. Yeah.
So it's kind of driven in my mind, 13.7 billion years, 13.7. So should I now be saying 13.8?
Yep.
Yes, 13.8. Right. And there's been hints of this from before. There's three measurements that are essential for determining that, yes, there had to have been a Big Bang, and then trying to pin down the parameters of it. The one is looking at type 1a supernovae, so white dwarfs that blow up and shine, their luminosity goes up by about a billion times. Because it's always carbon fusion, they blow up the same way, so you can use them as a standard candle to measure distances. That's come up with a slightly higher measurement for Hubble's constant, but two other things called baryonic acoustic oscillations, the idea that you had sound traveling through the universe early on. And it's like, wait a minute, it's this space. Sound doesn't go anywhere in space. If you go back towards the time of the Big Bang, it's much denser. And so with it being denser, you can transmit sound. And so these sound waves got frozen in the way that where there's more matter and where there's less matter. And you look at this distribution, and it gives a Hubble's constant of less than 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec. Planck also comes up with a Hubble constant slightly less than 70 kilometers per second per megaparsec, and this changes the age of the universe. If it's not expanding as fast, when you run time backwards, you get to the Big Bang in 13.8 billion years, 13.83, instead of 13.75.
Cool.
And there's an NPR blog called 13.7, so they're going to have to change it to 13.8.
Yeah.
The extra time in this you know, extra 80 to 100 million years into the age of the universe kind of also gives a little bit of that of a buffer into the time that stars and galaxies can start developing, because, you know, the further they look back, it seems that they keep finding these stars having formed and galaxies having formed earlier than they think or earlier than they previously thought they would have. Well, this gives a little extra time before that where that formation can actually take place, I'm assuming.
Yeah, an extra 100 million years at the beginning is actually pretty important.
There is one other thing that Planck nails down related to this, and it's called reionization. So you had electrons and nuclei come together at the time the cosmic microwave background became visible, 380,000 years after the Big Bang. And no new radiation is introduced into the universe until stars start to form. And so one of the questions is, okay, so how long after the Big Bang did stars start to form? The problem is it's told in terms of redshift. So redshift meaning looking at the expansion of the universe, how far back in the expansion do we see stars start to form? It's a redshift of about 11.4, which fixes it around, I guess, about 350 million, 400 million years after the Big Bang. But if the Big Bang is pushed back by an extra 100 million years, then it pushes that time also back by the same amount.
Well, let's move on. We'll let people sort of... I think this is going to be one of those stories we're going to be covering again and again over the next couple of years as additional data sets are released. And I know this is just like, you know, one data set that's been finally presented by the researchers.
Right, it's half the expected data from the first 15 months of observation. So they'll have more data releases in 2014 and 2015.
All right, so let me move on, because, again, we could talk about this all day. So I think the next story that I want to talk about is the Apollo rocket engines that were recovered from the ocean floor by Jeff Bezos' exploration company. And these are the Apollo F1 rocket engines from the bottom of the ocean. And I got a picture here. Let me see if this is going to work. That's great. Now, Alan, you worked on a story for this, right?
Oh, yeah. Very interesting that Jeff Bezos, of course, Amazon.com billionaire, but he's also a fan of spaceflight. In fact, he founded this company, Blue Origin, that has received money from NASA to develop new launch system that can be used for suborbital as well as orbital flights. And he has an interest in space history as well. And so this is one of the things he wanted to do as an inspirational adventure, educational thing for the next generation, is try to recover these Apollo F1 engines from the first stage of the Apollo Saturn V rocket that went up.
He's not planning on using this for his system.
No, I don't think so. They're kind of used equipment. They're a little smashed up, as you see from that picture.
Right, a little bit of salt corrosion happening.
So last year, he said that he and his collaborators had identified the place where the Apollo 15 engines went down, and so they've been planning this trip. They went out for 3 weeks a while ago, and recovered these engines using a pretty interesting remotely operated vehicle and a system that if you look at a video of the recovery effort, it really looks like there's somebody down there who's picking up this thing and putting it in a box and bringing it up, but it's all done by robots. And so the thing is that they haven't really been able to positively confirm that these are from Apollo 11, but they are from one of the Apollo missions. That was the idea, is that the first stage would power the rocket off the pad and then fall into the Atlantic. So these weren't really expected to be recovered, but they've done it. They're bringing them back, and the equipment will be restored to some extent at the Kansas Cosmosphere, which has done a lot of work with space artifacts. They're not going to try to bring them back to the way they looked when they were on the launch pad. They were pretty dinged up, and Jeff says that's part of the point, that this kind of shows the power of the whole enterprise, the stage going down at 5,000 miles per hour through the atmosphere. And so the agreement that was worked out with NASA even before the expedition went out is that the first engine display would be at the Smithsonian's National Air and Space Museum, and that the second one would be here in Seattle at the Museum of Flight. Of course, Seattle is the headquarters for Amazon.com, and it's where Jeff spends a lot of his time, and so they're thrilled to be able to get this. No word on exactly how long it's going to take to get all this work done, but one of these days you'll be able to come out here to Seattle or out to Washington and see these engines yourself. Pretty neat.
I will. It's reasonably close to me, and I will absolutely go and check that out.
So, Alan, if we've got a model here of a Saturn
V,
it's basically
those
these
five
guys, yeah. These guys right here.
Those
the
are the ones.
Ones.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And so another thing, Jason, is that NASA has been looking at those engines again, and in fact firing off some test versions of the F1 in order to figure out what the design is going to be for the next generation launch vehicle, the SLS. Mm-hmm. And so, as they say on Battlestar Galactica, this has happened before and it will happen again.
All right, well, why don't we move on? So this is – now, have you got the XKCD – has someone got the XKCD comic queued up here? Because I think we'll want to show that off in a second.
Oh, I've got it here.
Okay, good. So this is news, and this was at the I'm not sure where they announced this. But anyway, Voyager 1, the venerable Voyager 1, has left the solar system. We've now got official proof that it has finally left the solar system in that it is –
Again,
right? Traveled beyond the influence of the sun and exited the heliosphere. So I think I don't know if anyone can give that. I don't know. Can you give that kind of technical explanation of what the heliosphere is so people can know where that is?
So just like the Earth has a magnetic field that protects us from, you know, most of the influence of the solar wind and the particles that come from the sun, the sun's magnetic field also protects sort of the solar system from the influence of the rest of the galaxy. But you go far enough away from the sun and the strength of the field falls off to the point where now you start getting an influx of particles from the rest of the galaxy. But again, if you look at Earth's magnetic field, a coronal mass ejection comes in from the sun, it squeezes it down, it changes its shape. The sun's magnetic field is even more dynamic than Earth's magnetic field. So finding where's this boundary, about 110 astronomical units out from the sun, the fact that the boundary doesn't seem to be terribly well defined. Yeah, it's crossed the boundary. No, it hasn't crossed the boundary. Yeah, it's crossed the boundary. No, it hasn't crossed the boundary. The boundary can shift.
But so, yeah, doesn't in space sometimes the boundary crosses Voyager?
Yeah, you know, most likely. Yeah, it's yeah. Like you know, the film Machete, right? So and
but no, but just that the fluctuations, right? Just fluctuations with the with the solar wind, depending
back
on the amount of activity.
Boundary crosses
yeah,
you.
Boundary crosses you, right? So you have the situations where you get a little Voyager. Voyager crosses the boundary, and then the change in the solar wind, and the boundary crosses Voyager again. So
right, and I mean, you know, I don't know enough about Voyager's instrumentation to say whether it can tell whether it's passed or whether the boundary's passed back across it. I doubt it's sensitive to enough to do that. What it can do is say, okay, now we're getting more cosmic rays, now we're getting fewer cosmic rays. Well, if there's more cosmic rays, then the boundary's behind us as opposed to being ahead of us. So,
okay, here we go. So this,
okay.
And this is great. And so this is the latest XKCD comic, which the moment I heard this news as well, this is exactly what was going through my mind. Like, wait, didn't it already do that?
Yeah, and the funny thing is that JPL says, no, it's still in the solar system. So it is a matter of definition, and what JPL is looking for is a change in the kind of the magnetic orientation of the spacecraft. Mm-hmm. They're looking for that particular signal to say, okay, that's the dividing line. What JPL says is that, okay, Voyager is on this magnetic highway right now, which is on the edge of the solar system and traversing that, but it's still officially in. So it kind of, I'm waiting for somebody to come up with the answer, the punchline for the joke.
The whole big hullabaloo
started. Why did Voyager cross the magnetic highway?
the whole big thing started because the
AGU.
The American Geophysical Union put out a press release referring to a paper that said basically, yes, we've crossed this boundary,
right.
We're out of the solar system, you know, and you know, I guess it also depends too on how you define out of the solar system. You know, is it oh, you know, we've passed the orbit of Pluto? Well, Voyager did that back in 1994. Are we you know, out past the Oort cloud? That's not going to get there for a long time. So it's this idea of, you know, well, we're going to say that the solar system ends when the sun's magnetic field influence ends, and now you're into interstellar charged particles and interstellar magnetic fields. So, you know, has this happened? No. You know, JPL came back and said no, we haven't seen that the signature in Voyager's magnetic readings yet. It's still within that solar influence. You know, that like you said, Alan, that magnetic highway. So, you know, you end up having these conflicting. I mean, the whole space news internet thing blew up when that happened. It was going back and
right.
forth. It was actually a lot of fun to watch.
Uh-huh. And eventually, AGU revised the release. And so at first it said Voyager is out of the solar system. Now it says Voyager has entered
space.
A new region of space, yeah. Which is what JPL said back in December.
Right. So we're joined by Dr. Nicole Gallucci.
Hi.
Hi.
Sorry, I'm late. Had another meeting.
That's all right. We are somehow surviving without you. So I'm going to move on, just because I got so many stories I want to talk about today. So the next one I want to talk about is Comet Pan-STARRS. And I think this is just a great, you know, I think I've been calling this the year of the comets, 2013, year of the comets, Pan-STARRS, Lemon, Ison. This is it. This is the big one. So get a chance to go out and see some comets. And so the one that's in the sky right now is Comet Pan-STARRS. And Thad, where can people go if they want to see Pan-STARRS?
Well, it was closest to the sun and closest to the Earth at the beginning of last week. So if I remember correctly, perihelion was on the 8th, perigee was on the 10th. I might have those flipped. So the best time to have seen it would have been around those dates. But if you have binoculars or if you have a telescope, it's going. If you have binoculars, it's going to be visible for probably another 2 months. With the telescope, even longer than that. And so, what we're showing here in the picture west, that's, well, it was equinox this past week, so that's where the sun set. So if you're looking for where the sun set, one fist marks 10 degrees, and so we have 285 there, so that's a fist and a half to the right of sunset. 300 degrees would be three fists to the right of sunset, and then it's going to be about 10 degrees up. But it's getting farther and farther to the north, and by sometime in early April, it's going to be circumpolar for the northern hemisphere, for most of the United States. So you would be able to see it all night long. It's going to be low to the horizon throughout the night, but by mid-April for most of the U.S., it's going to be a circumpolar object. It'll be fainter. It'll be a binocular telescope object. If you have dark enough skies, you could potentially pick it up with the naked eye now, and I've had seen several reports of people being able to do so. But that time is going to come to an end soon, within the week, I would imagine, unless the comet starts to break up or something, and then we get a bigger outburst, and then suddenly it could brighten. So, I mean, again, it's a comet. Watch it, because it can do surprising things.
And that's a possibility, right? Is that it can, that parts of it might have broken off, or something might have flared up.
Yeah, I saw a story on Space Weather where somebody said they were imaging, and it looked like it had fragmented. I haven't seen a follow-up on that, though, so it's you know, I would still put a question mark and kind of a doubtful on that. But if it does, you know, then what you end up with is not one comet, but a line of comets. Or maybe, you know, if it goes into two pieces, you get two comets that are kind of moving across the sky together. So kind of like, you know, what Shoemaker-Levy 9 looked like before it hit Jupiter. Right? It was this kind of string. And that could look really cool. I mean, if you're looking, what is it? I forget the exact date, but sometime in early April, it passes very near the Andromeda Galaxy in the sky. Get out somewhere dark, get a nice wide-angle shot, you can get the comet, or if it fragments, more than one, and the Andromeda Galaxy in the same shot. So, you know, it's heading farther north. It's going to start passing through the thick of the Milky Way in about mid-April, and it'll be circumpolar for most of the United States at that time.
I think for most people, the best thing to do is, you know, a little bit of planning, because you do need to be out there right after sundown. Take, you know, if you've got like a DSLR and you've ever tried to take some pictures of the night sky with like your camera, then, you know, set up where you know it's going to be and try to do some longer exposures, like a 30-second exposure, and see if you can get the comet there as a faint object, because it's, you know, it's going to be fairly large in your field of view. It's just so faint that you really need that CCD and the camera collecting the electrons to get a view of it. But
and just from my own experience with shooting it, if you have a zoom lens on your DSLR, you want to shoot between about 100 and 200 millimeter focal length. You're going to have to be zoomed in fairly tight on the region of the sky where it's going to be, and probably about a 10-second exposure at this point. And then you can at least identify where it is in the sky. And you can say, oh, it's above this tree or this telephone pole. And then you can kind of have an idea of where to point your binoculars or even try to find it with the naked eye. So having a DSLR to scout it out is going to be a big help.
Yeah. All right. But I think, you know, hopefully Comet Lemon is going to be pretty good. And that's coming up in, I think, May. And then And then ISON by the end of the year. Hopefully, if everything goes well, it's going to be... Yeah, I know. You won't even need anything. You'll need sunglasses to watch it. Or well, nothing. Or
nothing. I mean, the amazing thing with ISON, if it does what they think it's going to do, you know, it's going to be very near the sun. It'll set, but the tail will extend into the sky after sunset and after darkness. And it's like, why is there this extra beam of light going up in the sky? That's the tail of the comet.
That's the tail of the comet, yeah.
So, yeah.
Okay, great. So I think now one of the people who's not here with us this week is Pamela, and that's because she was at the 44th Lunar and Planetary Science Conference. And but there's some interesting news that's been coming out from there, and one I think that Jason you picked on was these jets coming out of Enceladus, the fact that they reach all the way down to the salty ocean beneath 10 kilometers of ice. So
yeah, that was surprising. That was a fascinating little bit of news. You know, Saturn's my favorite planet, and Cassini mission is one of my absolute favorites. And so Saturn's got, you know, 62 moons. And a lot of people pay attention to Titan because it has the atmosphere and some of the other ones there. But Enceladus is a really fascinating little world. I mean, it's only about 300 miles wide. It's not a real big moon, mostly covered in ice. But they found back in 2005 with the Cassini mission that it's shooting these jets of icy vapor out into space and basically creating this big hazy ring around Saturn, that, you know, the E-ring. And it's all just the stuff that's coming shooting out of Enceladus. So the question is, well, where is this liquid water coming from? I mean, obviously it's coming out frozen, but it's starting off liquid. So it's being shot out of the southern pole of the moon, and there's these stripes down. They call them tiger stripes. There's these fissures down there that basically scratch across the bottom pole of the moon. And so these jets come, you know, basically every time the moon is backlit by the sun, Cassini gets some really great images of these jets coming out. And I'll pop up a picture of, oh yeah, Fraser, you already got it. So, and you know, every time the Enceladus is backlit, Cassini gets some really great images. And there's about 98 individual geysers, individual jets of this stuff coming shooting out. Based on the data that's coming from Cassini, these jets are actually warming the fissures, the tiger stripes, and they're doing so in such a way that the warming is coming around the area where the geysers, where the jets are emanating from, meaning that the heat is coming from wherever, it's probably a subsurface ocean, coming all the way from the ocean up through the cracks, heating the areas around the jets. And the reason that's important is because it means that the liquid water is not being created inside the fissures and not coming from an ocean, okay? It's coming all the way from wherever the subsurface ocean is. And because if it was coming from just inside the cracks, just inside the walls of the fissures, then the heating would be a little more uniform all the way up and down the tiger stripes, and that's not what they've seen. They've seen warm spots correlating to where the jets are coming from. So that's kind of a big deal, because basically Enceladus is spraying its liquid ocean, its liquid salty ocean, right out into space. So to sample this, all you basically have to do is fly Cassini or another spacecraft right through it, and test this stuff, you know.
That doesn't sound risky at all.
Yeah, no, not at all. You know, but I mean, but seriously, I mean, you've got moons with subsurface oceans like Europa. Well, if you want to test that, you've got to get onto the surface and either sample the surface or find a way to get down miles of ice to get down into that. Moons like Ganymede, you know, if there's a subsurface ocean there, you've got to get down onto the surface and melt or drill. Enceladus is spitting its habitable zone right out into space. You know,
I wonder if, and again, I mean, if there would be a way to detect for life, same kind of thing. You could, you know, almost like Stardust, right? You know, the Stardust mission where they flew and picked up pieces of a comet.
The aerogel,
and so you could imagine something similar where you could do some kind of Enceladus ocean retrieval mission where you fly through this you know, the spray with right. some kind of collector and then bring it back to Earth and then look for evidence of some kind of organics in the material. That would be really
intriguing.
Well,
I'm sure that's what makes the whole idea so intriguing. Now, you know, unfortunately, Cassini isn't set up for that.
Yeah.
You know, it's not made to actually gather samples of stuff and investigate them or to send them back to Earth. I mean, imagine if you could do that. But, you know, maybe future spacecraft will, and this gives a reason to actually build something that can do that.
That is really cool. All right, well,
I should also just mention, along with this real quick, I mean, Mike Brown was able to detect that the oceans on Europa were salty through a rather lengthy logical follow-the-dots kind of thing, but it depended on Io being there providing sulfur. Mm-hmm. There's no such source in Saturn, so the same thing couldn't quite be carried out at Enceladus. But maybe we'll think of another way that doesn't involve, you know, trying to get funding for this long, very risky mission.
Yeah.
Very imaginative, and I like it. But yeah, good luck getting that passed at this point.
Well, you know, Cassini's already flown through those jets, you know. So I mean, to say, I don't know how much risk is actually involved, but you know, it's come pretty close to Enceladus's surface and gone through the jets and done its own testing. Unfortunately, it can't technically sample the stuff.
Yeah, that's the problem. Right. Is it, you know, might have the stuff all over it, but it can't actually detect. You know, whether
there's
or not
actually critters
on the windshield.
Right. It's like, Cassini, can you lick yourself and see if it's salty? I mean, yeah, so.
Yeah, yeah, and, you know, like, have it, like, have some camera kind of look, and you could see a little, you know, little critter squirming around on the outside of
that would be
Cassini.
Scary.
Let's keep Cassini.
Prometheus.
Away. Yeah, let's crash that into Saturn as planned, because we don't want to bring that back to Earth. Cool. All right, well, so I think we got one more story that we're at a couple we wanted to, but I know we're kind of running out of time, and this is one that I think was really interesting, which is the asteroid defense hearings. Now, Alan, were you watching these? Can you set this up?
Oh, yeah. I know we're short on time, but I think basically the theme was, gee, if there were a big asteroid coming for us, we'd really be in trouble. One congressman asked, well, what do you do if you see a big object coming at us with 3 weeks of advanced warning? And NASA Administrator Charlie Bolden said, well, my advice would be to pray. And so there are other things you can do besides pray. We were talking about this, Thad and I. For example, plan an evacuation if you know where something is going to hit. If you have what they call a city killer asteroid, you can do some preparation. But in terms of deflecting asteroids, we're nowhere near that yet. We're still trying to cope with the challenge of trying to identify these asteroids in advance so that we can have some advance warning and try to look at ways to do it. General Shelton, the commander of the Air Force Space Command, was also on the panel for the House hearing and said that, you know, if time gets limited, nuclear is the best option to try to divert an asteroid. People talk about other things to do, throwing paintballs at it or using a gravity tractor, but right now the last resort would be the nukes, just like Armageddon.
Right, but I mean, it's one of these situations where, I mean, these missiles are designed to blow up other cities, not designed to be shot towards an object out in space. So they're not going to have the right kind of booster. They're not going to have the right kind of tracking, you know, to try and retask a nuclear weapon to be able to then throw it at an asteroid that's only a couple of weeks out is hopeless.
Oh, a couple of weeks, that's not good news.
Part of the problem is this. Nuclear weapon, attack a surface. An asteroid is a volume, and much more massive, you're not going to be able to do much to it. One other thing, I'd worked on this, and I know I'd floated by Jason and other moderators for the space community, is I've started putting together a petition on whitehouse.gov to increase the funding for this kind of thing. So I'll see about revising that and publishing the link to it later, and then if you're an American citizen, please sign this, because we have nothing we can really do.
Yeah. Let
me just mention that this also was addressed in something from the Space Access Society, and so people can do a search on warning shots, Space Access Society, and a discussion of how you address that sort of thing. And I'll put a link in the comments on YouTube on this, so people can check it out.
Yeah, I mean, I'm really glad that there's a lot, there's a much more increased awareness of this problem. And in fact, this is actually, you know, one of the things that got me so interested in space advocacy and activism, and even like running Universe Today, was this thought of like, you know, we need to get the information out. We need people to be aware that there is really this risk of space objects. I mean, a lot of people don't even think about it. And then you get this explosion in Russia, and suddenly now everyone's thinking about it and everyone's coming on board. It's interesting. I've got some contacts at some of the new space mining, asteroid mining companies that are happening, and the word is that they're getting tons of, you know, much more interest. So it was, you know, to have that asteroid explode in Russia has actually been very good for them. It's brought a lot of investors, a lot of increased awareness of sort of the demand. Well,
we're past by you know, half a dozen good size asteroids at various distances every single day.
Yeah.
You know, if you go onto the JPL Near Earth Object website, you can see that, you know, over the course of any particular day, usually at least one, if not, you know, four, five, six of them come by Earth. And they may be, you know, they may be a lunar distance away. They may be 10 lunar distances away. A few of them come a lot closer than that, like DA-14 did a couple, last month.
Yeah.
But you know, they're out there, and these are just the ones that they've seen. That's the kicker, is you've got to identify them first.
Yeah.
I'll say this: there was a lot of interest in what these folks have to say in Congress, and so members of Congress, even though they talk about sequestration in the budget and all that sort of stuff, they're very interested in making sure that we don't get hammered by dinosaur killing asteroid, for what that's worth.
I mean, I think one of the big problems with this situation is that it's a global problem, and so it's like global warming. You can see how difficult it is for world nations to come together to tackle a problem that we have.
Whose
really
cost
clear...
center does it come out of? It's like the cry that you have in any business. Whose budget does it
who's
come out of?
Yeah, right. Whose budget? Whose fault is it? Who's going to build the rocket? Right. Who's going to staff it? And, you know, oh, we'll let the other guys do it, and then it just gets put off, right? So, yeah, I mean, I really think, you know, a lot of things that really excite me the most is like the B612 Foundation, you know, because they're saying like let's learn to land on, let's learn to map all the asteroids, let's learn to land on an asteroid, let's really get to know asteroids and start to experiment with changing their direction, so that, you know, if we map them, we'll know down the road that where they're all going to be, and then if we have experience in moving them, then if we do find one with a potentially dangerous trajectory, we can shift it to another, you know, into another trajectory that's
yeah. They
that's
have
not
their Sentinel mission coming up,
yeah.
In a couple of years, and that's going to kind of take over where WISE left off, and, you know, get a good vantage point where they can spot where the space telescope can spot asteroids in infrared.
Yeah, and I think if you get these private companies that have this infrastructure, that are they regularly go out and reach asteroids and, you know, by all means mine them, they're going to be the people that you can then go to and say, oh, by the way, we kind of need that one moved, and they'll be like, yeah, no problem. We'll, you know, while we're, you know, we will move it by mining it. Mm-hmm. Right? So hopefully that's all moving forward. I think there's enough companies. There's Planetary Resources, there's B612 Foundation, there's another one by Rick Tomlinson and group that just came out. So I think there's like three independent...
Deep Space Industries, yeah.
Yeah, Deep Space Industries. So there's three independent organizations all determined to reach out, land on asteroids, and, you know, mine them, but at the same time be able to track and move and identify them. And I think that we've got three organizations able to do that, and maybe more down the road. I mean, boy, if Planetary Resources comes back with bucket loads of platinum, you know, and gold, then I think people are gonna head to space, and then I think that problem goes away. So
you're very optimistic.
100 years down the road. No, if there are bucket loads of platinum and gold coming back and they're able to make a profit out of this, then I think it'll be very interesting. I'll feel a lot safer that there are companies regularly going to space, mining these asteroids and moving them around than I am right now.
Moving them around carefully.
Carefully,
carefully,
yes, of course.
Yeah. Oh yeah, we shoved it. Oh crap, now it's on a collision trajectory.
They should at least have to take basic mechanics.
Well, to paraphrase Neil Tyson, I mean, how embarrassed would we be for, you know, a very, very, very brief period of time if, you know, we had the technology to deflect or stop a major asteroid impact, and we didn't do it. We could have fixed this, but we didn't do it.
We didn't do it. And we're at the situation now where we've extracted all of the easily harvestable resources off the surface of the planet, right? All of the oil that exists in big bubbles on the top of the planet have been used up. Now you've got to have these crazy contraptions out in the middle of the Gulf of Mexico, and you know, and you've got to be like using
we got to frack
to get oil, right? So all the easy oil is gone. All of the easy deposits of iron and gold and all this stuff is all gone. So if we do end up getting hammered with a big asteroid and it resets civilization, all of that ladder back up into technology is gone. And so
we'll be the next oil fields.
We're the future dinosaurs. 200 million years from now, the intelligent race of insects will be digging up,
pumping dead humans into
exactly. we're driving around with dead humans. Yeah, absolutely. Awesome. All right, well, I think we should wrap this up then.
No, I got here. I want to say something.
Okay, go ahead.
Thank you. No, I actually wanted to address a comment I noticed on YouTube from Orju asking if we could tell something about the Herschel telescope. And so I looked this up really quickly. This is from a few weeks ago, but we've been off air for a few weeks. So the Herschel Space Telescope is an infrared telescope run by ESA, the European Space Agency, and its mission is coming to an end because it's going to run out of cryogenics for its detectors. And so when you have an infrared telescope, you need to keep all your instruments really, really cold so that it doesn't give off a lot of infrared light and mess with your observations. And so that is what's happening with the Herschel Space Telescope. It's planned. They knew this was going to happen. It's going to run out of coolant. When it runs out of coolant, it can't observe anymore. So the Spitzer Space Telescope, which was put up by NASA, went through that as well, but it also had near-infrared detectors that didn't require coolant, and so they continued in something called a warm mission. So Herschel does not have those kind of detectors. They're all mid-infrared. And so the telescope, when it runs out of cryogens, it stops working. So that's what's happening with the Herschel telescope.
Awesome.
So thanks for that question.
There you go. Just so people don't think that we're ignoring their questions and
right.
comments. We do.
Love
we do.
You.
We care. all right, cool. And I know people got to get back to what they're doing. So, Alan, where do we find more Alan Boyle?
Yeah, well, cosmiclog.com will get you there soon enough.
Awesome. Is that a zero in your Twitter handle?
It is a zero, yes. So watch for that.
Does that ever run into any cause you any trouble?
Yeah. What the heck?
Yeah. Jason, where do we find more Jason Major?
I'm at lightsinthedark.com. I also visit Universe Today, Discovery News, and I'm on Twitter at JPMajor.
Awesome. And Nicole?
NoisyAstronomer.com and CosmoQuest.org and Discovery News, where I have been writing all about my amazing trip to Chile to see the Atacama Large Millimeter Array. So
those were some fantastic pictures, Nicole.
I know!
Oh my gosh!
We are all super jealous.
I've got video still to come. Matt Kaplan from the Planetary Society posted some really awesome video and audio blogs you should check out. It was good. We'll still keep the content rolling.
Awesome. Dr. Szabo.
So, still teaching at Cerritos College, and I think you'll see me starting to pop up possibly some other places, maybe Universe Today, maybe. You know, CosmoQuest. So, should be joining in on some of these other projects with
one
you guys
of
here
us.
Soon. So, yeah.
I love it. Freaks.
Yeah, exactly. Great. And, of course, you can find my site is universetoday.com, where I don't write a lot, but lots of other people do write. I tend to publish.